Welcome Chitra Banerjee Divakaruni, Nayomi Munaweera, and Sujata Sen to talk about the art of living, the art of leaving. Pardon the Freudian slip. Side by side, to make up for the time that we have lost, we are contemplating pushing the session with Anita and Kiran Desai to the Western Quadrangle and making it a simultaneous session. Otherwise, we will not be able to complete all our sessions today. But for the meanwhile, please welcome Chitra Banerjee Divakaruni once again, Nayomi Munaweera, and Sujata Sen to talk about diaspora and the art of leaving.
To the front rows. It's cold back there, so just move up.
I don't know if you guys heard, but Anita Desai and Kiran Desai are at the Western Quadrangle.
Yeah. And we'd love for you to be an intimate audience, so come up, you can hear us better, you can ask questions better, etc. Okay, while you are settling down in the front rows, a very quick introduction to the panel here. Chitra Banerjee Divakaruni, I think most of you here would have either read her books or heard about her. Is the author of 16 books, including Oleander Girl, The Mistress of Spices, the most well-known, I think, Mistress of Spices. Sister of My Heart, The Palace of Illusions, and One Amazing Thing. Her works have appeared in the New Yorker, The Atlantic, and The New York Times, and has won, among other prizes, an American Book Award. She was born in India. I think you lived also in Calcutta.
Yes, yeah, I did all my college presidency. Yeah.
And she currently lives in Texas and is the McDevitt Professor of Creative Writing at the University of Houston. Nayomi Munaweera, have I got that right, Nayomi? Was born in Sri Lanka and grew up in Nigeria. She emigrated to the United States in her early teens. She lives in Oakland, California. She already has two books. So the debut novel was Island of a Thousand Mirrors, which won the Commonwealth Prize and was up for the DSC Prize, and her latest book, What Lies Between Us. The session is called The Art of Leaving, and very interestingly, we have two writers here who have, in a way, left, but also not left the countries from where they began. So I'd like to ask Chitra and Nayomi to tell us a little bit about yourselves, you know, so that we set the context about art of leaving.
Sure. Okay. Well, I lived in India for the first 19 years of my life, at which point I went to the United States for graduate studies. I finished my college here in presidency, and I continued studying literature in America, got my PhD, started teaching, and along the way felt a great need to start writing. Writing about immigration, writing about India, writing books that moved from India to America and then back again as well.
So, Nayomi?
First of all, thanks so much, all of you, for being here. And I'm so honored and thrilled to be on this panel with Chitra, who, you know, when I was a young person doing my PhD, before I dropped out to be a writer, your books were so influential. And it was so important to see women of South Asian origin write our stories. And you were one of the very first. And I'm just so honored and thrilled to be here with you. So thank you.
Thank you.
My own story is that I was born in Sri Lanka in 73. In 76, for economic reasons, my family moved to Nigeria, as many South Asians did. And we were in Nigeria until 84. And then in 84, there was a military coup in Nigeria. And they sort of told the Asians to leave very quickly, as happened in Uganda. And we ended up, we went from this very small Nigerian village to Los Angeles. And I was 12, and we have been in Los Angeles since. I'm now in the Bay Area. But again, like, my childhood and my adolescence was really marked by going back to Sri Lanka. We would go back every year for about a month. So there, it was this sort of like existence between, and very much going back and forth. Of course, there was also a war in Sri Lanka from 83 to 2009, which my first book is about, which complicated everything. So I think that the idea of leaving and then constantly coming back and then what have you left, all these issues really worked themselves into my book, perhaps much like yours.
Yeah, I just wanted to add to that. Yes, for me too, I would come back to India from time to time, and I was always struck by a combination of two things. One is all the things that had changed, and also everything that had not. So it was a very interesting experience. And I was never sure what kind of India I was coming back to, but it was very, very interesting. And then as I had children whom I brought to India, that became a whole other experience, bringing your child who's born somewhere else back to your birth country. And all of that has informed my fiction, so I have stories about second-generation Indian-Americans coming back to India.
Chitra, this latest book, Before We Visit the Goddess, as I went through the book, I felt that most of your characters were not really very happy characters. That's the feeling I got as a reader. Why are they unhappy? Is the experience of leaving home and going and living in another country an unhappy experience? Has it been an unhappy experience for you?
That's a good question, because first of all, of course, I want to make the separation between myself and my characters. Many more exciting things happen to my characters than they do to me. And they are, as with many stories, stories are set around conflicts. So you will see them in moments of conflict. This is particularly true in Before We Visit the Goddess. It is a three-generational novel, but it's also a novel in stories. So the transformative moments of these women's lives have been chosen by me to create this narrative. I would say that they have several unhappy experiences. Now, the three generations, the grandmother, Shabitri, lives all her life in India. So her experiences, both happy ones and unhappy ones, are happening here. She has two left, in a sense, because she's left her village home and she's living in Kolkata. She's lived in some other cities in India. But I would say that all of these characters, her daughter is the immigrant. She goes, Bila is the one who goes to the US, and perhaps I'll read a little bit from that moment of transition. And she will also have happy and unhappy experiences. And the final one, Tara, who never come back to India, will have her share of mixes. So I think their happy experiences are often have to do with their creativity. And their unhappy experiences perhaps have to do with moments when they've depended on other people to create their happiness. And I think that is something that possibly transcends all cultures, and we would see that everywhere.
Also, your characters have very unusual relationships. You know, Shabitri has this relationship with Bipin Babu, Bela with Ken, and Tara with Dr. V, the scientist. You know, I found that very interesting that yes. You've got very poignant moments when these three women have these relationships. Just do tell us a little bit more about this, and why do you do this?
Okay, so in this book, this is something new and different in this book. And in this book, I wanted to show just what you were talking about, that first of all, we have many kinds of relationships, but the two that I'm looking at are relationships with actual family members, the grandmother to the mother to the daughter, so the three generational ones. But often, although we love our family and we have this very close bond with our family, often these relationships are also fraught with a lot of tension, maybe just because of that love. And sometimes when we are in real trouble, we can't turn to these closest relationships. And sometimes the help comes from elsewhere. So in the life of Shabitri, it's Bipin Bihari, the manager of the sweet shop that she owns, that she can depend on more than anyone else. She has quite a, you know, thorny at times relationship with her daughter. She can't depend on her, and her husband's dead. So this is the man. And then Ken, who is a neighbor when Bela is probably at the lowest stretch of her life, just comes into her life and manages to help her transform herself. And Dr. V, whom Tara, the granddaughter, will meet only for one day, is going to help Tara make a very important and positive decision about returning to college. So I think I wanted to look at the irony between how much effect our families have on us, which is one kind, but sometimes how strangers can come into our lives and they can be transformative.
Naomi, I felt the same about your book too. Not too many happy things happening. Of course, in a civil war, one wouldn't expect happiness to come through more than unhappiness. But did you have a personal experience of the Sri Lankan civil war? It ended in 2009. By that time, where were you? And how much of personal experience of actually going and seeing what's happening to the Tamil and Sinhala families affect you?
First of all, I think I'm just going to echo Chitra in that I think just for me, really good literature isn't about the happy moments. It's about really testing those moments of pain or ambivalence, or when I think about the books that I really love, something like Beloved or Lolita or War and Peace, I mean, you know, there's some happiness in there, but most of the time we're really delving into the dark psyche and the sort of psychological darkness. And those are the books that really speak to me. I love this quote by Franz Kafka, which is, a book should be an axe to break into the frozen sea within us. And those are the books I love, and that's what I hope, or you know, that's what I want to do with my books. So yes, there is happiness, there's joy, there's beauty, there's the balancing of horror with food or family, or in the second book with flowers. But at the same time, it's really about exploring the darkness. So as you said, the first book is about two women who go through the Sri Lankan civil war, a terribly brutal war that we had in Sri Lanka for 26 years. And my relationship with it was both intimate and distant. As I said, I left when I was three and spent most of my life sort of in as an immigrant. But I had very close family in Sri Lanka through all those years. My aunts and uncles, my cousins were all in Sri Lanka. So I think this is the case with many immigrants, especially Sri Lankan immigrants. If there was ever a phone call in the middle of the night, you woke up in sort of a terror because you didn't know if a bus bombing had happened. You didn't know if one of your family members had been killed. My most intimate encounter with the war is when I was about 14. We were in Sri Lanka at a flower show and it ended up getting bombed. And again, I don't say that to sort of say that I'm some sort of expert or that I lived through these things, and people went through much more horrific things, but that was a moment that I really understood what people were living with. We were in this big flower shop. My cousins and I went out for ice cream, and there was a big loud noise and a boom, and it had been bombed. And then they were bringing out stretchers of people. I think I don't know what the body count was. I think it was very small. It was a small incident, small enough that it didn't make the papers, which again is an indication of how bad things were at that point. And that evening we all went to dinner and the family was teasing each other and sort of making fun of it. And I realized, okay, this is what you have to do to live in these circumstances. You have to sort of get on with your life. You have to make fun of it, really. Otherwise, you can't survive. So those were the sort of the background images that I had as I wrote that book. It was a very, both an intimate and a sort of distant. It was more an exploration of my own relationship with that war and what it meant to live in America and relative safety as my extended family went through this.
It's interesting how, you know, we're talking about leaving home and how both of you have chosen very different formats to explore what you are, you know, to explore the story. Chitra, you've got the story moving from one set of years to another character, another set of years, then coming back again. You know, just tell us a little bit more about why you particularly chose this form, you know.
Yes, before we visit the goddess is a different form from anything I've written before, because it is a novel in stories, and it is not even necessarily chronological, although I have put the dates of what's going on with each story, with each chapter. And I chose this because I really wanted to focus on the power of memory. And you know how when we think back on our lives, we don't think of it chronologically, necessarily. We think of one incident, and associatively we think of another incident, and then we might go back to an incident that was earlier. And that's how I wanted this novel to flow. I wanted it to be in the voices of the three women, but I also wanted the voices of these other people, Bipin Bihari, Ken, Dr. V, there are other characters who comment on the lives or remember the lives of these women, and they have a whole other angle. And so, and some of these stories, I used, as I'm sure you noticed, I used unusual formats. There's a story, for example, that goes chronologically backwards. There's a story, for example, that is told in a doctor's office as one of the main characters, Bela's husband, is filling out a medical history form. And through it, we get the story of his life and his relationship with his wife. So I wanted some different ways of approaching immigration, the life of an immigrant family. And I wanted to show that it's not necessarily chronological, the power of these stories.
And Nayomi, your format is again completely different, at least in your first book. There's very little dialogue, and there's a lot of narration. Why did you particularly choose this way of telling your story?
That's a great question. And you know, it's been a few years since I wrote that book, so you probably are a bit more intimate with it than I am right now. I think these stories, they sort of come to us in the form that they come to us, and they reveal themselves in a certain way, you know? The way that I think about a book, it's an obsession that comes to me and sort of takes me by the hand and I have to go with it. And I might write that story over and over again 20, 25 times. So both of these books have been rewritten and rewritten. And what finally emerges is the purest distillation of the way that I can tell that story. So for example, the first book had about four times bigger, and it had a tremendous amount of politics in it. And at some point I realized that wouldn't be interesting to people. So what I'm interested in as a writer, and I think what readers are interested in, is feelings and the emotions of characters. And if you can connect with the emotional life of a character, you are bound to go on that journey. So for both of these books, that's what I was really interested in, trying to capture a really intense, intimate look at certain characters. So this book, for example, is about... it's about a woman who's committed a really terrible crime. She starts out telling you she's in jail and she's done this awful thing. And then she says, I won't tell you my name until I explain to you the course of my life and why I have done this thing, and I'll tell you what I've done. And so it's a book about maternity, and it's about the influences of culture, and it's really about the dark side of maternity.
Okay, since we've spoken about the way you've done your narrative, could we have a reading from both of you?
Sure.
You want to go first?
Okay, so this is a different reading from any I've done this time over here at Column. And this is in the voice of, or in the consciousness of Bela. She is the middle generation. She is actually contemporary pretty much to me just a little earlier. So she grew up in Kolkata or spent many years in Kolkata. She went through college during the Nakshal years. And that is, just to give you a little background, that is the time when the man she fell in love with, he was very involved in politics. He got in trouble with the Nakshals and he had to flee the country. He managed to get to the United States, but he kept in touch with her. And she runs away from home to be with him. And the moment that I've chosen to read to you is the moment of arrival in the United States. And for me, that was, personally, that was a very powerful moment, both positive and painful, because it was like a complete break from everything I knew. Remember, I went to the United States in the 1970s, long before there was any internet. I didn't know that much, and once I was there, the ways of communicating back with people at home were very few, and they were very expensive. So it was a real cut off. And I've tried to just capture that moment with its excitements and its fears in when Bella arrives. This chapter is called Beggars Can't Be Choosers. It's set in 1973, and I'm going to read you a little bit from it. When Bella arrived in the United States at the age of 19, carrying papers that falsely claimed she was a tourist, Sanjoy was the only person she knew in the whole country. He wasn't her husband yet. The plan was for them to marry as soon as she got here. She was crazy about him. How else to account for this desperate thing she had done? But perhaps she didn't trust him all the way, because when the airplane landed in San Francisco, her palms were slick with sweat. Where would she turn if he wasn't out in the lobby waiting for her? But there he stood on the other side of the frosted double doors, thinner than she remembered, his scruffy student beard replaced by a trim, responsible-looking mustache. Grown, he told her later, so that Americans would take him seriously. He looked as worried as she felt. It struck her that he too had had his doubts. Would she really give up for his sake everything she was familiar with? Drop out of college? Cut herself off from her mother? A wound never to be totally healed, because that's the kind of mother, that's the kind of woman her mother was. Bella had thought she knew what love felt like, but when she saw Sanjoy at the airport after 6 long months, her heart gave a great, hurtful lurch, as though it were trying to leap out of her body to meet him. This, she thought, this is it. But it was only part of the truth. She would learn over the next years that love can feel a lot of different ways, and sometimes it can hurt a lot more. But on that day, the lurching made her forget the cart with her suitcase on it and run through the crowd to Sanjoy. She threw her arms around him the way she never could have done in Kolkata and kissed him on the mouth. No one catcalled, no one harassed them or took umbrage or even noticed, except for an old man who offered them a pensive smile. When she had breath enough to speak again, Bella said to Sanjoy, "I think I'm going to be happy in America." And he, smiling, said, "I know you will." But Bella had been wrong. Someone else had noticed them kissing, and once she surfaced, she noticed him too.
Thank you. This is beautifully read.
Thank you.
Nayomi, will you read from your second book? And this book is where is this book set?
This book is set 1/3 in Sri Lanka and 2/3 in San Francisco. Well, sort of in the Bay Area, exactly.
San Francisco.
And having Chitra read first actually makes this much easier because I'll read the same moment of arrival, which is why I let you go first so I could figure out what to read. This is chapter 8, and what's happened to my character. She's about 12 years old, much, I suppose, like me, although this is fiction, of course, and not memoir. And through a series of traumatic events, she has found herself immigrating with her mother to the Bay Area, to America. So this book actually has nothing to do with the Sri Lankan Civil War. The traumatic events that have happened to her are personal, and they're within the family. So it's really about the secrets of the family. So this is chapter 8. We land in Fremont, a suburb in Northern California, full of wide open freeways, a sky that turns plum at dusk. This is a place where life is lived inside houses, on silent streets, and in strip malls. There are some sari shops, a few ethnic restaurants, but the predominance of brown skin, of Afghanis and Pakistanis and Indians that will come to mark this place is far off in the future. We are few and far between. These are lonely days full of misunderstandings. In those first few weeks, I saw unbelievable sights. A woman walking down the street with a small black dog on a leash, a plastic bag in her hand. At home, a dog like this, a mutt, would be left to wander by itself. It might be beloved, but nobody would leash it and walk it. It might perhaps follow at its owner's heels, but only a dog of some preciousness, a discernible breed, would be put on a leash and led. Much more than the dog, what catches my attention is that mysterious bag in her hand. Full of what? I watch astounded as she stoops down behind the dog's lowered flanks, the plastic bag spread wide in her hand, and scoops up shit. She ties the bag and walks away, as if the bag is precious, as if the dog has bestowed upon her a treasure that must be carried home and savored. How impossible to imagine in this richest country of all, people are saving dog turds? For what possible reason? My imagination boggles at the question until Darshi, my cousin, my guide to everything in this new place, explains. There are other, more serious differences, of course. On the island, we were fixed in place from birth. We knew where we fit. You were this person's older sister, that person's second cousin on the father's side, that one's older cousin. Names would tell you everything about a person's placement in the complex, familial, and community matrix. The naming described your destiny from birth to burning. In Sri Lanka, when two strangers meet, they ask a series of questions that reveal family, ancestral village, and blood ties until they arrive at a common friend or relative. Then they say, "Those are our people, so you also must be our people." It's a small place. Everyone knows everyone. But in America, there are no such namings. It is possible to slip and slide here. It is possible to get lost in the nameless multitudes. There are no ropes binding one, holding one to the earth. Unbound by place or name, one is aware that it is possible to drift out into the atmosphere and beyond that into the solitary darkness where there is no oxygen. Thank you.
Nayomi, your first book, I want to get back to that book again because of the context of the war. And you've been away from Sri Lanka for many years now. You've visited on holidays or to meet family. And there's a lot of personal experiences there. There's a lot of historical context setting. Where did you do this research? Back in the US, or did you come to Sri Lanka to do this research?
When I was writing the book, so the book came out originally in Sri Lanka, and then it was bought in India, and then it was bought in America. So it came out in 2012 first. So I finished writing in 2009, right as the war ended. I was mostly in America. I was doing all my research online and reading everything that I could. And I was doing the research that way. Since the book has come out, I've been very involved with communities that have suffered and have gone through experiences in the war. So I do a program with Shyam Selvadurai, who I hope most of you know. He's this incredible Sri Lankan writer, and he wrote a book called Funny Boy, which if you haven't read, you should read that. So Shyam and I do this program in Sri Lanka called Right to Reconcile, and what we do is we take youth from all the communities, and we do a residential workshop, and this last year in May, we went with the students and we lived in the sort of middle north of the country. And we went to the north, to Jaffna and Vaunia, and we interviewed survivors. And we are putting together their stories and we're putting together their narratives. And these are, we've done this program for 3 years. The first year we did it, when we went to the north, we couldn't interview anyone. There was such a heavy military presence. People were scared. They didn't want to talk. And of course, absolutely understandable considering what happened at the end of that war. This year, when we went in May, we interviewed survivors, and we could take they would let us take pictures of them from the head down. So you couldn't take identifying, but they talked to us. We talked to an ex-former Tiger cadre. We talked to many survivors. We talked to a guy that had shrapnel wounds all over his body. And then we went to, so we did those interviews, and then we went to a Sinhala border village where the Tigers had blown up a bus and killed, I think, between 50 and 60 villages. And we're compiling all those stories, and our students are writing fiction based on that, and we're putting out an anthology. It's called Right to Reconcile. So since the war ended, there's a lot more access. So as much as I did whatever research I could for the first book, but it's been really interesting because the book is actually taught at the Jaffna University, which I don't think there's a better sort of complement to the fact that people are accepting it as, okay, this is as close as fiction can get. So I'm quite happy and honored about that.
The Sri Lankan government had a very violent reaction to Western media's, particularly BBC's coverage of the war. So what was your response to that, to either the Western media, the way they covered the war, or the way the Sri Lankan government responded to it?
I mean, the Sri Lankan government at the end of the war said there were zero casualties, which is laughable and ridiculous, right? I mean, the numbers are still contested. I'm not a politician. I'm not a historian. I'm an author. So I don't really want to delve into politics or contested area. But I will say, I mean, the final battle was absolutely a battleground. And the people I have talked to talk about seeing their fellow villagers in the lagoon dying. I think the lowest body count was 40,000. So the fact that the past Sri Lankan government had it at 0% is quite ridiculous. We have a new government, and hopefully things are getting better. From my perspective, I do think they're getting better. But again, this is very, very touchy. And any Sri Lankan you talk to will have a different opinion about it. So as a writer, I think that I need to stay within the realm of fiction. I hope that answers your question. Mm.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I will also say that when my book first came out, it came out in 2012, as I said, and at that point, the entire media was controlled by the government. And it was quite a frightening time because they were disappearing writers and journalists. So when I did my launch, I did a very small, quiet launch for this reason. When I did my launch, the pro-government newspaper editors came and they voraciously sort of attacked me on stage and said, how dare you write this, you're an outsider, et cetera, et cetera. Which is, you know, I grapple with that outsider, insider perspective quite enough for myself. So what I had to say to them is, have you read the book? And they said, no, we haven't. And I said, well, you might want to read it before. So, you know, I mean, nobody showed up at my door. There were no white vans. It was okay. But if I had been a Sri Lankan person living in Sri Lanka, if I had been a Tamil writer, I would have been in much more danger.
Okay, let's come to another aspect, which
go and have their spices sent. So, but people did that too. So food became a way for them to really connect back with their cultures, to keep the culture going, to remember things, because when we eat certain things, there are many memories associated with it. And I've used food in all of those ways. And also, as the second generation is born and grows up, well, what is their relationship to food? And a lot of times, like Tara, for instance, towards the end of the book, there's a moment where she's going to cook a dish for her mother. And her mother wants her to cook like a Bengali dish, a very Bengali kumro tarkari. But Tara looks at, and her mother by now has become a famous cookbook writer. So Tara looks at the recipe in the book, and there's like 27 ingredients. And Tara says, well, I'm going to have to really shortcut this recipe. So, you know, it, with every generation, food is a living, changing thing, how we relate to our culture through food. So that's one thing. But also, I think because I write stories where women are so central in the stories are told from their viewpoint, or it's their lives, food becomes very important, because at once it is like a traditional symbol of womanhood, but many of my women have taken food and, as it were, run with it. Shabitri becomes an entrepreneur because she opens a sweet shop, especially at a time when most sweet shops were owned by men, and she's venturing into that world through food. She also begins to create new recipes. She's going to create a Shandesh recipe that she's going to name after her mother. And so it's a way for women to empower themselves and to take control of their lives. Her daughter, Bela, will become a food blogger and a writer of cookbooks. So, but also in other books, which are not at all about immigrant life, such as my Palace of Illusions, Draupadi will use cooking to empower herself as well.
As you pointed out, my books are sort of dark and horrible.
not horrible.
Not horrible. Well, hard. But let's say horrible dark. Subject matters.
Yeah.
And I think, like, for each book, what I've done is I've counterbalanced it with something beautiful and joyful and sensuous. And so for the first book, it's food. So, you know, as Chitra said, it's like the most fundamental, joyous connection to the culture that you've lost. You know, I was thinking about, as you were talking about, the fact that in our brains, they say that scent and memory are located quite closely, and most of taste is scent. So when you smell something that you know, you've forgotten, it will bring back all these memories, and food works in quite the same way. When you know, I'm sure all of you have something in your childhood, whether it's, you know, something from your village, or it's grilled cheese or whatever, that evokes all this emotional memory of maybe your family, your mother. And it's universal, right? It's absolutely universal. So I use food in that way to evoke not quite nostalgia, but that deep sense of belonging and cultural sometimes loss. Because here's sort of the sad part about my life. I live in San Francisco. There is not a single Sri Lankan restaurant in the Bay Area, which is sort of like the saddest part of my life. You know, it's awful. It's very, very sad. Imagine if you couldn't get the food that you love, you just couldn't get it. So this is like a constant longing for me, and I put all of that longing into the first book. The second book, the counterbalance to this this very sort of that my character, who's gone through quite terrible trauma, the counterbalance is flowers. And especially dahlias. So I'm just thrilled to be here in this city with these like incredible dahlias, and they're just bursting forth with different shapes and colors and sizes. And I'm just like thrilled to be here, because like I didn't realize this. So it's intimately connected to this book.
I just wanted to say one other thing, which is food can also become a source of real conflict in immigrant life, especially as you're bringing up children. And most children that I've seen, they go through a period, usually when they're in middle school, where they want to dissociate from their home cultures if they're from other places, because they don't want to stand out, they want to fit in. And then they don't want any Indian food, they just want American food, and that causes a lot of trauma in like the parents. But fortunately, you know, the nice part is after they go away to college, suddenly, and I've seen this in my own children, they're like, we want mom's food, we want mom cook that old recipe. And then even better, they're like, teach me how to make that recipe. And then, you know, then it comes full circle.
Are you a good cook yourself?
Sorry?
Are you a good cook yourself?
Yeah. I don't know. I was going to say yes, but my husband's in the audience, so I don't know.
We'll ask him later. Yeah, but it shows through your books.
Yes. Yeah. I do have a food blog where I've simplified traditional recipes and also put up some recipes from before we visit the goddess. So I have one of my favorite desserts on my blog, which is chocolate shandesh. In the audience likes chocolate shandesh? Yes.
And Nokure chocolate shandesh is the best here in Calcutta. Okay. Would you like to read from...
I just talk about food a little bit more?
Yes, because it's so
potent. And I think, I was just thinking about this as you were talking. When we moved to America, I was 12 and my sister was 3. And I remember very specifically, she was in third grade. She was about, I think, 9 or 10. And she came home from school very upset because a teacher had said a mark of a culture that's still savage and hasn't been civilized is eating with the hands. Now, of course, as Sri Lankans, we eat with our hands at home. And this was like such a moment of disconnect from the culture all around us. And this moment of, wow, okay, we are seen as savages, really, and we are separated from the culture around us. And I think especially for my sister, that was like really a moment of sadness. And then I have to juxtapose that with now my sister is an adult. She's a lawyer. She has a 3-year-old of her own. And I went to visit them. And, you know, the 3-year-old's been learning to use knife and fork and a spoon. But I eat with my hands, and I'm very happy to do that. And I think it's like the way that the food, Sri Lankan food, should be eaten. And my 3-year-old niece now is eating with her hands. So I'm really proud of that.
It's a circular movement, isn't it? I think as an immigrant community gets more and more comfortable in their new country, they feel more empowered to bring back the things that they loved when they first moved.
I have just a couple of more questions, but particularly one, which is maybe a predictable and maybe a cliched question, but I'm going to ask you deliberately because there is much more, I think, in the answer that you'll give me. And this is about why it's the title of your book, What It Is, especially before we visit the goddess, because I found that very, very interesting, you know.
Okay, yes. The title of this book is Before We Visit the Goddess. That is also the title of one of the chapters in the book. The title has several meanings, one of which is most literal, because in this chapter, Tara, the granddaughter, who has now, because of many reasons, many tragedies, she's dropped out of college, which is very ironic because her grandmother had wanted to go to college so much and she couldn't. And Tara, who was able to go to college, dropped out. But she is now working as a driver at the university, and she's asked to drive this man from India to an Indian temple in Houston, the city where I now live. This is the Meenakshi Temple. And so the goddess, the literal goddess referred to in this title is Goddess Meenakshi. And there's a sentence where Dr. V, the man she's driving there, says, before we visit the goddess, we must cleanse ourselves. And, he washes his hands and feet, and she does too before she goes into the temple. So that's the literal meaning. But before we visit the goddess, I think has a symbolic meaning for me because it refers to the search that I feel has become very important to me in my writing, especially since I wrote Palace of Illusions, where I begin to see our human journey as a spiritual journey. And as we go on this journey, as we grow on this journey, we become more and more in touch with our sacred selves, with the goddess within. But before we visit the goddess, before that can happen, sometimes we have to go through tragedies. Sometimes we have to go through hardship. Sometimes we have to learn also how to be compassionate and how to forgive not just others, but ourselves. And these women will go through these journeys, which I believe is important for all of us. And when that happens, then we are in touch with the goddess.
Island of a Thousand Mirrors was the result of 3 months of a really hard title search. we finally came up with that title, which I'm quite happy with. So it's Island of a Thousand Mirrors, and it was I was trying to portray the fact that a civil war is about fighting the mirror image. So you're really, the Tamils and the Sinhalese in a certain way are such intimate enemies. They've been on this small island for generations, decades, millennium, of such a long time. So, you know, in the West, people are not going to know the difference between a Tamil and a Sinhalese person. But of course, in Sri Lanka, this is a difference that could mean the life and death sort of difference. So it's about fighting the self and fighting this very intimate enemy. What lies between us, it works on several different levels also. It's literally what lies between the couple. So it's about a couple, it's about love and what is between the couple, and you can take that literally or figuratively. It's also lies, so untruths. And I think on a deeper level, a novel is a collection of lies that tells the truth. So this is a collection of lies that hopefully leads the reader to some sort of truth about life.
Well, I wanted to add a little bit about the title Palace of Illusions and why I came up with it. And this too has meanings on different levels. On the literal level of the text, this refers to the Mayapuri, the Palace of Illusions that will be built for the Pandavas by Mai Danav. And it will be built in the middle of a wilderness, which will be transformed then because of this palace. It is the home that Draupadi has been searching for all her life. She helps to design it in this book, and she will lose it. But on the other level, again, there's a spiritual meaning where the Palace of Illusions could refer to this entire world that we live in, which is ultimately an illusion, and as we live our lives through this and gain some spiritual understanding, we begin to see that everything's changing, everything's fleeting, and everything is, in some ways, if you go back to the Vedantic way of looking at the world, it is an illusion.
Thank you. Should we open up to the audience and take a couple of questions?
Yes.
Any questions? We can take two or three questions, I think, at the most. Yes.
In front, can we have a mic?
Well, thank you. This is a special observation for our dear Sri Lankan writer. I'm just back from Sri Lanka. Spent 3 weeks there. Absolute paradise and God's made country. And I thought the food all over, whether it was in Kandy or in Colombo, wherever I went extensively in search of James Taylor, who brought in tea to Sri Lanka. Anyways, but your food is so delicious. I'm very upset because the Bay Area, which offers fantastic food, otherwise I've been there hundreds of times. My brother lives in LA, so you know it's always a good excuse to go there. And I'm very upset to hear that they have not recognized the status of Sri Lankan food, which I think is the most delicious food in the world. Thank you so much. Fight for it and become an activist for it, please.
Thank you.
That's any other questions?
Lovely to hear.
Yeah. Can I see any hand going?
I see a hand there.
Yeah, I can, yeah.
This is to Chitra, ma'am. Since you are a successful writer and also teach creative writing, I want to ask, in case of a successful writer, how much do you think that a writer is just inherently talented or is just better at expressing themselves in words? Or is writing just like any other skill which is acquired through practice or hard work?
That's a great question. How much of writing is something that you're born with and how much is what you gain through hard work? And you know, that's a tricky question, because when I started writing, I wrote because I felt this great need to tell this immigrant stories, lives that I was seeing all around me. Things were changing so much, and then I wanted to write about the India I'd left behind, which I remembered very vividly. I wasn't really very good when I started. And maybe the, you know, the talent was there inside me, but it was not like on the surface. And I had to do a lot of writing and rewriting before I got better. So in the beginning, I would write stories and I'd send them to magazines and they'd be sent back really quick with rejection notes that basically said, please don't quit your day job, right? So, and I shared this. And I share this with you because, you know, sometimes people think if I'm not a very good writer right now, I can't become one. But I think with careful practice and with really wanting to tell the story, I think that's the part that's really important, that you have a story and you're just dying to tell it. You can't rest without telling it. And then you can work at improving your technique. What really helped me was joining a writer's group and getting comments, being aware of my weaknesses and my strengths, and kind of being able to let go of my ego and saying, all right, this is not working, I have to get better. So I'm a great believer in working through our errors and becoming better.
Should be ending with Nayomi talking
Nayomi
about...
Can, yeah. Yeah.
I think the biggest thing that you need to do is read a lot. And just read and write and really practice that skill. Those skills, you need to practice them almost daily, or in fact daily. So I don't think you have an MFA either, right?
Do you? No, neither. I didn't.
Neither of us have studied creative writing, but I think we read a lot. And again, you cannot underestimate how much editing needs to happen. I think young writers think that it sort of flows out of you in this perfect, beautiful way. And that is not the truth. It comes out looking really ugly and messy. And if you saw my first drafts, you wouldn't even, they would be incoherent to you. So it takes at least a year, 2 years, 3 years, some writers 10 years to perfect that thing into something that's beautiful and coherent and clear. And perhaps that skill can be taught. So it's really a combination. And I mean, the biggest thing is patience. You have to be incredibly patient and learn your skill. This is a skill. It's also a spiritual practice. You sort of have to give a lot to it, and then it will sort of generate back.
Well, you talked about how your first drafts were not that good. I'm very vain, so I've destroyed all my first drafts, and you'll never know how bad they were.
On that beautiful note, we'll bring this discussion to a close. Thank you so much, Chitra. Thank you so much, Nayomi.
I had a question. Yeah. I was raising my hands for some time.
We are out of time. You can ask the authors when...
Just one question.
Yeah, they'll be out.
We will be going to the bookstore to sign, so I know we are running behind. Other writers are waiting to come on stage. Please come to the signing area. We'll be happy to answer questions. Right, Nayomi?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all very much for being such a wonderful audience.
Thank you, Sujata Di. Thank you, Nayomi. Nayomi was wonderful yesterday as well. She helped us out when Stephen wasn't well. And thank you, Chitra Di. The 3-year wooing, your husband said it was worth it for him, and I think it was worth it for me as well. So a round of applause for Chitra Di. Sportingly did 3 sessions for us at this festival. So thank you so much for that. Chitra Di and Nayomi will be signing books at the bookstall.